With each other all night long. Here to query everything I say, ah, quick to criticise, Jason Manford. Yeah. Constantly quibbling, Aisling B. Quashing all opposition, Anuvab Powell. And, oh, will you be quiet, Alan Davis. Some particularly pugnacious buzzers, Jason goes. Oh, that's horrible, isn't it? Oh. Aisling goes.
Sounds like my. So sorry.
Anuvab goes.
I was hoping the attention wouldn't come to me after that.
And Alan goes.
Oh yes, it is.
Oh, yes. Wow. The audience are so pleased with themselves they can't carry on. What happens when you quarrel with the bellower?
Sandy, I'm new to London, and I'm beginning to realise that when someone has a dispute or a quarrel, the English language works at two levels.
Yes.
I realised in Britain when someone says to me, Anuvab, I have a slight issue. Yeah. It means I've killed their whole family.
Yeah. I think that is entirely true. Okay, so the bellower is the nickname of an actor called James Quin. He was the leading actor in London in the first half of the 18th century.
What has he come as then?
Well, that apparently is him giving his Coriolanus.
Is it really?
But I think it's more anus than Coriolanus. He was unbelievably quarrelsome, and he actually killed two people in duels and wounded multiple others. He had one of the loudest voices in show business. He also did excessive gesticulation, and he left extremely long pauses. These were all the hallmarks of a great actor at that time. So would-be actors were schooled in three different pauses. There was moderate, longer, and grand. And because you're all natural performers, I thought we would see how you would fare on stage in Quinn's era. So we're going to act out what's written on the script cards that you've got on the desk. So Jason and Anuvab, a bit of quarrelling, please, from Titus Andronicus. Very loud, very big gestures.
Yes.
Pausing.
OK, here we go. Villain, what hast thou done?
That, sir, which thou canst not undo.
Thou hast undone our mother.
You do know after that.
That's very good.
I was taken aback for
it. Yes, no.
Do a grand pause.
Villain, I have done thy mother.
That was an early your mum joke from Shakespeare.
I like that.
He invented the word quarrelsome, actually. It's in fact the only word he coined beginning with Q. It comes up in As You Like It and in The Taming of the Shrew. Right, Alan and Aisling, I've got an EastEnders style script for you. I'm actually going to take a small part in this myself.
Oh!
I know. So, you know, big gestures, big pausing. Here we go.
Okay.
Oh, Aisling. I remember saying, we're Barney Rubble with me, old trouble and strife. She found a pair of your Anna Wickers in my Lucy Locket.
Oh, Alan. You absolute donor. You need to be more careful.
Now! What What's this all about? You cow!
You cow, it's you!
Say this cow! You're not my mum.
Actually... she is.
See that making a comeback as a style. So, Quinn killed two people. The first man he killed was an actor who mispronounced Kato as Keto on stage.
I'm like that with Pacific and specific.
Oh, yeah.
I just take them out long range.
So, Quinn mocked him in front of the audience, and the guy decided to challenge him to a duel, and in fact, he was killed.
He mocked somebody?
Yes.
The other bloke looked like.
He only got done for manslaughter, and that was it. Then he just went back to work, frankly. He was a notorious womanizer. There's a marvelous story. He once invited a married woman to his boudoir, and then he realized he'd forgotten his key, so he thought, oh no, I'll take her to a brothel. And anyway, awkwardly, her husband happened to be there. And the husband walked in on them, you know, in flagrante. And in the ensuing fight, Quinn stabbed him in the leg. Quinn's big rival at the time, David Garrick, great famous actor.
Oh, David Garrick.
First actor, in fact, to move towards acting rather than shouting.
Where's my glove? Where's my glove? Props!
But they were friends, and Garrick eventually wrote the epitaph that is on Quinn's tomb in Bath Abbey.
That's the Garrick Theatre named after him.
Yeah. I mentioned that James Quinn was handy in a duel, but now let's see how you fare. So, for this question, please start with your hands on your heads. We have changed your buzzers so they all make the same sound. Which of you is the quickest at pressing your buzzer? Go, 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 go! Oh, was slowest. I'm just going to check with VAR.
Yes.
Get the replay there. Yeah. OK. And the answer is... Jason! Jason, you were the winner! Oh,
there we go.
So, very good, but how would a Victorian have done it differently?
A Victorian?
Yes. It's whether you think the Victorians would have been quicker. Would they have beaten Jason?
No, I think slower.
Why, darling? Just because it's a long time ago?
Partly. And there's less things to, like, move out of the way off quicker.
So here's the thing. We would think, maybe, that we would be quicker today, but really, the Victorians had quicker reactions than we do today.
What?
So in the 1880s and 90s, there was a statistician called Francis Galton. He tested thousands of people to see how quickly they could react to lights and sound. And we have consistently got slower, so on average about 10% over the past century. And we don't really know why. So possibly modern pollutants have had an effect on our brains. That is a possibility. Possibly... this one I don't like at all. It's because we're taller, is one of the reasons given. So our nerve impulses have got further to travel in our bodies, and so they take longer to get to their destinations. But it does seem to be that the Victorians were a bit faster than us. And do you think boys or girls are faster?
Say good.
I'm going to say
be careful, Jason.
Yeah. Nice try, Sandy. Girls.
It's usually boys. But what they've discovered in the past 40 years or so is that the gap has decreased.
Or is it getting increasingly jumpy?
Yes. Left-handed or right-handed people quicker?
Left-handed people are the devil, so I would say right-handed people, Sandy.
I'm left-handed, so I'm going to say right.
It's left-handed people. You did win.
Of course, I should have used my own experiment.
Yes.
Damn it.
It's probably because most right-handed people are very, very right-handed. In other words, most left-handed people, so yourself and me, are more mixed. The two brain hemispheres of the left-handers tend to be more balanced and split to their work more equally.
It's one of the lesser disabilities. Look, I'm not... I don't want everything, just the blue parking badge. That's all I want. That's all I want.
Is more likely to cause a quarrel than a badly ordered queue. So my question is, what's the best way to board a plane? The people are in the lounge and you want to board them onto the plane. What's the most efficient way of doing that?
Minimise hand baggage, all those wankers who can't be bothered to check their bags and come on like mules, like pack mules, fill up all the overhead lockers with their very important shit. And sit down farting all the way to Malaga. Sorry, what was the question?
There's bitterness in this, isn't there?
I had a moment on a flight last week, actually, when I was flying from Aberdeen to Shetland, and I was with my tour manager, who's also a big chap, and we sit next to each other, cos we're pals, and there was hardly anyone else on the flight. It was only a small plane. And the stewardess came over, and she said, Mr Manford, Mr Isaac, she said, would you mind separating and sitting on either side of the plane?
Oh, no. Weight distribution.
Weight distribution?
They're as heavy as a wing.
What, so he's going to land like this if we...
Well, that's what you should have done. We will at the start.
Yeah.
But during the flight, we're going to set you a series of challenges. Zigzagging about the plane.
First time in the history of the world where turbulence is a person.
Yeah.
That's how I'm going to think of you now, as turbulence.
That's me.
By the back row, then the next row, then the next row.
That is the most common. Yeah, that is the most common way of doing it. It is also the least efficient.
Or in the middle, and then fan it out towards the back and the front.
Take the top off the plane. And have them all swarm in over the top like that.
So there's an astrophysicist called Dr. Jason Steffen. He made a computer model and then he teamed up with a TV producer to get people to act out boarding planes in various different arrangements. So he compared boarding from the front, from the back, at random, and what he called Wilma boarding, which is window, middle and then aisle. Nice. Block boarding, by far the slowest. That's the way the airlines currently do it. So they say this group of seats and then the next group of seats. The absolute best way to do it is board first the even-numbered window seats, followed by the odd-numbered window seats, then repeat with the middle seats and then repeat with the aisle seats. It's rather complicated. And so he actually recommends just board at random. That would still be much faster than what we currently do.
You don't want too random, do you? You don't want to be on, like, 16 rows back and the pilot's there.
I was boarding recently and this lady announced, we are boarding everyone not in zone F. And then she said, and also not in zone A, B, C, D, E. Then she paused and said, we're just not boarding.
I think there's two types of passengers. They're the ones who think that if anything happened to the pilot, they could probably be all right if they took over and got talked in.
Yeah, that's me.
And there's the other ones who would think there's no way they could do that.
I sort of fancy myself being able to fly a plane. You're right. I think I could bloody give it a go.
But don't you think that when you've watched a load of ER, for example, that you think,
I
totally could do that heart surgery?
I sort of feel like I'd be naturally good in emergencies. Like, I can't speak Spanish now, but I feel like if there was an emergency, I probably could give it a go.
Yeah. What kind of emergency suddenly requires Spanish?
I feel like there's a Spanish girl, Sandy. She's come in. She's choking. No one else in the hospital speaks Spanish.
Right.
Something's wrong with her.
Yeah.
She can mime, but we're not getting it.
No.
They haven't trained like me in the dramatic art of mime.
Of course.
And so she's like, paella, Madrid, Venezuela. And I'm like, don't worry. Penicillin. And then it'll just be like that for...
That poor child is dying and you're the last thing she sees. here's a randy scandy fact. There's another queuing study from the fine country of Denmark. Economists concluded the very best method of serving a queue is to serve the last person first. So, when you have a first-in, first-out system, it encourages people to queue. Mm. If the last person got served, nobody would start to stand in the queue because there'd be no point in it. Queues just cause backlog, and so it's much better to serve the last person first.
The way different people queue, you know, around the world can lead to problems. I had a friend of mine recently in Manchester went to use a cash machine. When he got there to the cash machine, there was a man already using the machine, and 6 foot behind the man, there was a woman sort of waiting her turn. So he says, are you in the queue for the cash machine? And she says, I'm Nigerian, and my religious beliefs are that because I don't know this man and we're not related, this is the distance that I feel safe and respectful, you know, to what I believe in. So, because Steve's a very thoughtful person, he then stands 6 foot away from her. You know, it's like a 12-foot three-person queue out of nowhere. Then the man moved, and the woman moved to the machine to do her money business. Steve then stayed the 6 foot behind.
Perfectly nice.
And he was in his sort of little daydream, and another man come over and said, "You in the queue for the cash machine?" And Steve went to explain, but not loaded with all the information, said, "I am, yeah, but I'm standing here because she's Nigerian." It's a minefield! Even when you're trying to be nice!
So, anyway, why might you put a mirror next to a lift? Any thoughts about this? We're talking about waiting.
Next to a lift or in a lift?
No, next to it. It's to do with you looking at yourself. People dislike waiting in line, but they do like looking at themselves. People don't complain if the lift takes a long time to arrive, if they can constantly see themselves. I love this picture, though. So we had an experiment to see if we could recreate this with all of you. So let's have a look. Are we able to do that? There. What do you think? Oh. I know!
Oh, it's Top of the Pops from the 70s.
Love it.
It's like a giant centipede.
That is brilliant.
That's really good fun.
Why? Can we do like the swimming thing where we go?
That's great.
This is
brilliant.
Beginning to look like a Bollywood movie.
It just keeps going after you finish.
Do you know what I did there? I actually tried to catch myself. Oh, yeah, yeah. You have me.
It's like synchronized swimming on your own.
Brilliant.
Yeah, very good. Our queuing advice is to really rile people up by ignoring the instructions at an airport and standing on the left of an underground escalator. That's really upset you.
That's the only thing I care about after Brexit.
Yeah.
Well, that's only down here that that's a problem.
That is London.
It's only London. Yeah. It's not even not even questioned anywhere else. Stand wherever you want.
You stand wherever you want.
Yeah, it's not a thing. Just a thing down here.
Stand on the right.
Not in anywhere else.
Fucking stand on the right.
Right. Who's famous for generating about 25,000 quarrels a year?
Piers Morgan. You don't have to say it.
Who's
Donald
that?
Donald Trump.
What? Donald Trump, yes.
Oh. You got another one?
Yeah. Katie Hopkins.
You're doing well. That's the three. Yeah.
What might a quarrel be? It's a thing rather than it's a dispute?
It's like a vase of some sort.
Why do you think it's a vase? It's a lovely idea. Why do you think that?
I have no idea what
it's Is it a hat? No.
So it's not a vase and it's not a hat. You haven't left us as much, Sandy.
We are going to go back in time. So between the 10th and the 15th century, what was the principal weapon of war, do you suppose?
Stink bombs.
The plague.
No, the crossbow. And the bolt for a crossbow is called a quarrel. Oh. And there was a man called John Malamont, and he was England's chief quarrel maker in the 13th century. He made up to 100 a day, so he made about 25,000 quarrels per year. And the earliest crossbows, I mean, this is a sort of an image of one of the earliest ones, they were really, really difficult to operate because it was so tight to pull it back. So you had to get on your back, use the strength of both legs, your back and your arms, in order to pull the mechanism backwards. Then eventually they invented something called the crossbow stirrup, which meant you could put your foot in the thing and then pull backwards.
That looks like he can bat fire pretty badly. That feels like before the adverts on You've Been Framed. Harry Hill's like, what's going to happen after the break?
Can I ask you, Sandy, weren't there female crossbow people who used to chop off their
bats? You're thinking of bows and arrows, and you're thinking of the Amazons who allegedly cut off their left breast in order to make it easier. Actually, it depends on which... Yeah. You'd cut off your right breast so that the...
You'd be annoyed if you cut off the wrong breast.
Yes, I know.
Joking.
Oh, yeah. No. I was looking in the mirror.
It must have been really odd for them when cannons and bullets came about.
This is the thing. What happened was guns superseded crossbows in warfare, so you're talking about the 16th century, and eventually crossbows became reserved just for recreational use.
I bet when guns come out, there were some pretty annoyed one-titted women knocking about. Chopped off my tit for this!
Right, moving on. It's time for the hostile interrogation that we call General Ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. What's the most dangerous part of this ship? Yes.
The buffet.
So you can see it. You can see it in this picture.
The lifeboat.
It is the lifeboats. You're absolutely right.
They're the most dangerous bit.
Yeah. So there was a safety study carried out by the Marine Accident Investigation Branch in 2001, and lifeboats killed more people than they saved in the UK and Australia over a 10-year period. In fact, they found it was the most common cause of death on board ship. It accounts for 16% of all lives lost. Almost all of the accidents happened during training or maintenance. And in the same time period, no lifeboat was actually used in an evacuation, so they didn't save any lives whatsoever. It is considered a really serious problem. Airplanes have a similar issue with their apparently life-saving devices. In fact, we can try them out now. We're about to crash land on water. Fortunately, your life jacket is under your seat, and since we know you always pay attention in the safety demonstrations, here we go. Brace, 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 find it, go, go, find the life jacket. As far as we can ascertain, life jackets have never saved anybody's life on a modern commercial airline.
I feel like I overreacted then, if I'm honest.
So you're going to take them off, so if you just take them. Can you get it off, darling? Can you?
No!
That's what this is.
Oh my God! Do you remember when that plane crash-landed on the Hudson?
I do, yeah.
Oh, when Tom Hanks was in the plane?
Yes. Only 33 of the 150 passengers who were on board had even managed to get hold of their life vests. And of those 33 who'd managed to find them, only 4 were wearing them correctly. They're only intended for planned water landings. In other words, when there's been advanced warning. And that hasn't happened for several decades. There's
well, I often wonder that when I'm flying Heathrow to Edinburgh, they give it all that. I think, well, that'd be a good shot, mate. Where are you going to... Right into Windermere. Yeah.
There's a woman called Cynthia McLean. She's the Federal Aviation Authority's principal cabin safety investigator. She says the best advice is leave the bloody life vest behind. It takes too long. And actually, the best thing you can do if you land on the water is get off the plane.
Why don't they replace them with parachutes? I've never understood that.
But if people can't put the life jacket on properly, who the heck is going to manage...
Why can't the plane be equipped with 2 enormous parachutes?
Yes.
So when it's out, when it's going down, they just release 2 enormous parachutes and it floats to the
ground. Like Wile E. Coyote.
Right, moving on. Where did the Great Fire of London start?
Ooh. Go on then, you think you know, go on.
Let the audience get it.
Go on then.
Is it? It's not nice. Makes you feel stupid, doesn't it?
At the monument.
So, well, closer to the monument than we thought. So it did start at a bakery. There was a baker called Thomas Farriner, and he left his fuel out too close to the oven. But they've now discovered planning documents from 1673. It was an academic called Dorian Gerhold, and he revealed that the oven was actually situated on Monument Street. So it's about 60 feet east of Pudding Lane. And of course, Monument Street wasn't called that then because...
There was no monument.
There was no monument.
Yes.
So the monument was built in 1677. Now, the thing about the monument is it's 202 feet tall because it was supposed to be 202 feet from where the fire started. But it's probably now too tall, because it probably started much closer to the monument. Anyway, moving on. How should you position your hands when holding the steering wheel?
10 to 2.
Used to be. Not anymore. Why not? We're no longer recommended.
Well, it's definitely not that.
Something has changed in cars since the origins of the 10 to 2 idea. What has changed in the actual development of cars? No, not seatbelts. It's what? Airbags is absolutely right. So if your hands are too close together, which is the 10 and the 2, it increases the risk of injury, and some of the injuries are horrific. Airbags inflate at up to 250 miles per hour.
Jesus.
Broken hands, entire hands, sometimes requiring amputations. There is a really stomach-churning injury called degloving.
What?
Yeah, very good.
So lifeboats, airbags. Like, what is... What, the paramedics just come round and slit your throat? Like, what?
The best thing is like that, 9 and 3, because that way the airbag has got space to come up between your hands. Keeps you out of the way.
I just stay with my cup. Just loop it round once. Yeah.
The British driving test changed in 2018. What did they get rid of?
Oh, that's good. I failed my theory test 3 times last year.
Have you passed now?
No, she hasn't. I do believe I'm just too much of a genius to grasp something so simple. That's my
theory. I failed the practical 6 times.
What did they pull you up on?
I got to a junction. I looked right. I said, all right, your side.
I failed my test because when I was meant to go forward, I went back.
They got rid of the turn in the road manoeuvre. That's gone, and that reversing around the corner is gone as well.
Yeah,
now,
good, that was hard.
Is that because that's creepy?
There's a wonderful survey they did in 2015 of the most common reasons people fail their tests. Unusual reasons for failing included, I thought a line of parked cars was a line of traffic, so waited behind it. I went too far forward at a zebra crossing and bumped the bumper on a pedestrian. And then argued it wasn't my fault as his outfit had made him blend in with the stripes. A good-looking man on a motorbike caught my attention and without realising, I started to drive directly towards him. The instructor had to enforce an emergency stop because I nearly crashed straight into him.
Driving instructors, just as a type of people, are quite mean. Mm. I was getting my driving test. I sat down, he looked at me and he said, I don't think you're going to make it.
Wow.
Wow, at least he wasn't a doctor. And with that questionable image in your minds, it's time for the scores. Well and truly quashed in last place with minus 37. It's Alan. In fourth place with minus 25, Jason. Place with minus 17, Aisling. In second place with minus 9s, the audience. And our winner today with a full 4 points, Anuvab. Me to thank Anuvab, Aisling, Jason and Alan, and I leave you with this quick quotation from the quarrelsome Elizabeth Gaskell. I'll not listen to reason. Reason always means what someone else has got to say. Good night.